today. Today's topic, we are going to cover some kind of cool legacy products is what I call them. Stuff that's been potentially around for a little while, but I think sometimes is underutilized or even sometimes kind of forgotten about by some retailers, industry members, and consumers these days. So some of the things we're going to talk about today, you guys, are some of our in-dash products. So we are going to talk about the 3.2, which is our in-dash EQ. We're going to also talk about the Epicenter in-dash, or the Epic 160, as some people call it. And we're going to talk about the Matrix as well, Matrix Plus. So three main things we're going to kind of cover today. And it's a little bit different because it's not all about DSP this week or all about software or any of that stuff. It's a little bit more traditional products, you might call it, but things that still I think are super, super useful and things that could still be used in a lot of today's systems and are actually, you know, kind of coming full circle in my mind. And I'll explain a little bit more about that here in a little bit. So for those of you that haven't been with us before or don't normally join in, we appreciate you joining us on Zoom and Facebook Live. On Zoom, like Chris Bennett mentioned, he'll be kind of monitoring the chat on Zoom. So feel free to type in your questions in there. He'll bring them up or answer them as we go or bring them up to me. And then if you're on Facebook Live with us, there is a small delay there, but feel free to type your questions in the comments, and Chris is monitoring those for us as well. So without further ado, we'll get started. And thanks for the compliments on the glasses, guys. I appreciate it. So yeah, this week we're talking about in-dash processing, some pretty cool stuff here that is very unique, I think, that is things that nobody else really has to offer these days. So stuff that I'm actually pretty excited to talk about. And you know, I think with this category, a lot of people look at it and go, you know, I think that's a dead category. I don't think in-dash processing is still a thing, or we get asked a lot, you know, I'm surprised you guys still make those. Do people buy them? Blah, blah, blah. And I can tell you from experience, so can Chris, yes, people absolutely buy these. They are still a very viable product and they're still something that is needed. And I think a big part of that too is that, you know, if you think about the in-dash processing or in-dash EQ, in-dash crossover, in-dash whatever, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago or more, this was a popular category, right? This was a hot category. You know, most everybody had a single DIN cassette or CD player, and that player didn't have a lot of tone control. It didn't have a lot of equalization or crossover points or whatever. And so, you know, a popular add-on, of course, was an EQ. And they were either adding it under the dash, or if the dash was large enough to accommodate it, putting it under the radio and kind of ISO mounting it all together, you know, whatever the case may be. And you know, most every brand 10, 15, 20 years ago had multiples of these to offer. You know, all of the big head unit companies that are still around today all used to offer these things, you know, as well as a million other companies. But today, how many companies are there that still make a in-dash EQ or crossover or processor type product that is of any even reasonable quality? You know, there's maybe a one or two, but nothing like there used to be, right? So this is one of those things where we still make some of the stuff that is really high quality, really, really nicely built. And just like everything else we do, has a five-year warranty, has all of the goodies that we're known for. So with that, let's get into the actual products themselves. And I'll move on to the 3.2 is going to be the first one that we talk about. So the 3.2 is a half DIN EQ. I've got one sitting here right in front of me, so I can kind of show this a little bit as we go. The 3.2 is a cool piece. If you are still looking for a high quality, you know, really well built, nice sounding in-dash EQ type product, this is a great answer. And there's a few reasons that I dig these personally, and we'll kind of go through some of that stuff. But just to kind of walk you guys through some of the features on this. So essentially the 3.2, the reason it's called a 3.2 is it's essentially a three-band EQ, and the .2 is essentially your bass or sub control, okay? So you've got three fixed frequencies here. We've got 10,000 hertz, 1.25 or 1,250 hertz and 125 hertz, okay? But for the low bass, we have two controls. We've got a sweep and we've got a gain. Sweep allows you to adjust anywhere from 40 to 80 hertz, and then gain is gonna be from negative 12 to positive 12, just like the other controls. So instead of being locked down to a specific sub-bass frequency on the EQ, you're able to set that to whatever you desire, which is pretty slick. So there's another couple of cool features on this guy that we'll kind of go through here. And one of those is the ability to quickly turn on and off the equalization feature, which is right on the product right next to the EQ. It says equalize, press it in, it's engaged, let it out, it's disengaged. So you can quickly show the difference or hear the difference between on and off, or maybe you have it running flat for when you're listening to talk radio, listening to the ball game. And when you actually play music, maybe you engage that, something along those lines. So some pretty cool stuff there. Off to the left of that, or to the right, to the left of that, we've got sub-level, fader, and master volume. So one of the things that I think is really cool about this piece, and something that makes it kind of unique is, there's been lots of EQs out there over the years. There's been, 7-band, 14-band, 30-band, everything you can imagine. This is obviously not a ton of bands, but it's really kind of everything that you need to do a simple, quick tune on something and give you some adjustment. Now, I mentioned earlier that, years ago, tons of people ran stuff like this because their aftermarket single DIN didn't have, much in the way of an EQ or much in the way of crossover points, etc. Well, think about that. What are we working with the most today? We're working with a lot of factory radios. We're working with a lot of vehicles that maybe don't have a true radio in them. And what do they have? They have little to no equalization, right? They maybe have bass and treble or a pop, rock, jazz, whatever type EQ, but there's not a lot of actual adjustment. So, this is a great piece for something like that where you just need to make some simple, quick adjustments, or maybe you have a customer that prefers knobs. Not everybody wants a full DSP. Not every vehicle or situation calls for a full DSP. The other cool thing is, this can be used as more than just an EQ, and I'm going to touch on that in just a second. So to continue kind of our walkthrough here, there's also a source switch on the front here. This can switch between the main input and the aux input, okay? So what's cool on this too that I think is really cool is there is an aux on the front and there's also one on the back, which is pretty slick. So we have our main RCA inputs back here, and then we have our front output, rear output, and sub output. So this has three sets of high voltage preamp outputs, which is awesome, and then a rear aux in and a front aux in. A really cool note on the aux ins, you guys, if you're putting this into a system and you're using the rear aux for maybe something like a satellite tuner or something like that, and on the occasion, maybe you want to plug in an iPod or an MP3 player or a smartphone into the front, you don't have to switch between the two. As soon as you plug into that front aux input, it automatically disengages the rear. So that's why there's just one source switch. It just switches between the RCA inputs and the aux inputs. You don't need to be able to switch from aux 1 to aux 2, blah, 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 blah. It's just RCA or aux, and then the aux's auto switch depending on if you have something plugged into the front or not, which is pretty slick. So the other thing that's on top here that's really cool is our gain adjustments. So with the 3.2, this is also a line driver. As with most audio control products, we talk about this a lot, just about everything we build has a line driver feature built into it. This is no different. This will give you up to 13 volts of preamp output voltage. So it's a pretty, hot output if you need it. So we can get a really nice clean signal sent down the line to, that DSP or those amplifiers or whatever it is that's down the line next in the signal chain. So one of the reasons that I think this is pretty cool as far as doing things more than just, EQ work is I think of this more as a potential head unit replacement for, vehicles that aren't your traditional car. So when we think about that, here's what I think of them as. Think of this as a potential head unit for marine applications, for classic car applications, or really anything else in between. Think about a, a golf cart, a side-by-side, a, whatever it is. I've got a little classic Datsun truck that doesn't have a traditional radio opening, and I don't want to cut one into it. I'm going to use this as my head unit. And think about it. This has everything that you need to build a really nice system and not have a traditional deck. And as somebody that was a retailer for a really long time, I can tell you the majority of my classic car customers really didn't want a radio. You know, we may have put a classic looking radio in their dashboard because that's what they asked for. But when you really got down to the core of it, 9 times out of 10, all they really wanted was something that sounded good, was easy to run and operate, and, you know, would sound like a modern system and not cut up their dash. That's what they were really looking for. And this really fits the bill for all of those things. You'll notice on your screen right now too, I show it in blue or red. It is one model number, you guys. All you have to do to switch the color is pop the top panel off of this, and there's little jumpers inside here I can show you in a second. And those are how you switch the color on this guy. So while we're talking about that though, a couple things to kind of consider with that too. And I brought this up, if you have ever been in one of my, you know, physical trainings where I actually travel around, you know, like we used to do back in the old days and do physical trainings in stores and things like that. One of the things that I usually bring up is the idea that, you know, at least here in the Pacific Northwest, where it's not nice all year round, these types of vehicles that you see on your screen right now, these get put away. Right? And up here in the Pacific Northwest, and I know in a lot of other parts of the country, people put these toys away for the winter. And so that, you know, that poses an issue when we're talking about traditional mobile audio. If you put a traditional 12 volt, you know, whatever brand marine stereo in that boat, or, you know, your classic car customer does allow you to cut the dash of it for some reason and allows you to put a radio in, or even puts one in the glove box or under the dash or whatever. Not only is it obviously harder to hide those things and make them cosmetically look like they belong there, but there's also the thought of when they put this vehicle away for the winter, what happens with the vehicle that gets put away for the winter? Generally speaking, the power either gets disconnected, or if they're not real meticulous about this, they leave the battery connected and it dies over the winter. And so what happens to all those settings that you took the time to dial in, or if you're a shop and you're doing this for them, all those settings that you know, you sat there and dialed in for them for half hour, 40 minutes, whatever, tuning the stereo and all these presets and all this stuff in their dash. And now they disconnect the battery in October, they pull the car back out in February, March, whatever. And the first time they go to enjoy it, it doesn't sound good. It doesn't sound like it did last fall or last summer when you installed it, because all the settings have been wiped. Now, obviously, are there some specialty marine radios and things that will combat that problem? Of course there are. Or would a battery tender combat that problem? Absolutely. But we all know, if you were in retail like I was, that a good majority of our customers are not that careful and are just not that forward thinking to plan ahead for that stuff. So I know I had customers every single spring that pulled out their toys and brought them to me and said, hey, this doesn't sound like it did, you know, last summer. So that's one of the advantages too of having physical dials, controls, and knobs on a product like this is, obviously, wherever you leave these controls is where they're going to be when you pull the vehicle back out in the spring. I know that sounds kind of silly and you know, almost stupid because it's so simple, but it's the truth. Wouldn't it be nice if you know for sure it's going to be exactly where you left it? Even down to what color illumination is set. It's a pin. It's a jumper that you move. It's not a button you press. So we know it's going to be the exact same setup when you pull it out every spring. That the same goes for boats. You know, when they put these boats away for the winter, the majority of them either turn off a battery switch, or they disconnect the batteries altogether, or they don't do any of that and the batteries just sit there and die over the winter. Either way, none of this is going to be the same when they pull it back out. So that's one of those things too, where I think it really makes a lot of sense to have a product like this in there, is not only are these controls going to be where you left them, but think about it like this. With either of the cars, or not cars, but applications that I just talked about, think about what that's like. We've all probably been in a boat before. We've all probably been in some sort of classic car before. Both of those specific applications pose some hazards when running a traditional 12 volt, you know, aftermarket stereo. And that is, if you want to adjust, say, the subwoofer output on a traditional stereo, what does it take to do that? Okay. All of you are thinking of whatever stereo you have in your car or something like that right now. But most of them are quite a few steps, right? Most of them are menu, audio, setup, subwoofer, level, and then you either turn a knob or press a button up and down. And then you have to either wait for it to go away or hit menu a million times to get out of that, right? If you're in a boat doing 50 miles an hour across a lake, trying to keep an eye on that mirror with the guy on the inner tube that's on the back and all that stuff, wouldn't it be a lot easier to just reach over and turn a knob, you know, to adjust the subwoofer up and down? Wouldn't it be easier to just, you know, when the guy falls off the wakeboard and you need to quickly turn it down, wouldn't it be easier to just reach over and turn down something that's readily available? It makes a whole lot of sense to me. Same thing goes for the classic car market. Those cars a lot of times are loud, loud exhaust, loud engine, loud whatever. And a lot of times they just need to make quick adjustments, right? They just need to quickly turn things down, quickly turn up a sub or a fader. And, you know, if you are a retailer that's watching this and thinking about this with me, think about how easy it is to teach someone to use this versus teaching someone to use a modern car stereo. You know, in my shop, I went out and spent sometimes an hour with a customer, you know, just teaching them how to use a couple $100 car stereo, something that for maybe all of us would be really, really easy and come naturally. You know, sometimes they make two or three trips back into your shop just to learn how to, you know, access the aux input. It's so much easier if there's simple controls. So there's a lot that I could say about that type of stuff. Obviously I could go on and on, but, just to give you an idea of some of the applications that I see for those, that is one of those things that makes sense to me. Sid Customs brought up a good idea with this too. And that's, a great point. And that is, you know, with this guy, talking about this being a head unit in some of these classic cars and things like that, this is kind of what I would plan for it if it's me. And like I mentioned, I'm probably going to be putting one of these in my own, my little classic Datsun truck that I've got. But I'm going to use the rear input on this for a Bluetooth streaming device. I'm just going to put a simple Bluetooth streamer with this. And now what I've essentially got in my dash is a Bluetooth streaming more or less head unit, right? Because I've got master volume, I've got fader, I've got sub control, I've got basic EQ controls with that advanced control on the sub portion of it or on the bass portion. And I've got three sets of preamp outputs that are high voltage. What more do you need, right? I'm not looking for AM FM in my classic truck. I'm not looking for AM FM in my boat because most of the time they don't get any reception anyway, right? And then, you know, when I do go for a cruise in that little truck and I want to plug in my phone, great. I've got an input right there. I can plug it in and away I go. So there's some really cool uses for these things. I think they make a lot of sense. And also with this guy, as far as setup and that sort of thing goes, there is on the top, I mentioned earlier, the right and left gain control. Okay. So you do have independent control of right and left gain. We also have a maximized light on here to help you set this guy up. So there's some pretty cool features built into this as far as being able to set it up, being able to dial this in. I'm going to pop the top off of this real quick and show you guys how this works. I've already taken the screws out of it, so you can see the top slides off. And then internally, this is what we're looking at. Okay, so inside here, there's a couple of things that we would want to pay attention to. One of those is my illumination is down here in the corner. That illumination, like I mentioned, just switches it from blue to red. It's as simple as moving a couple of pins over, no big deal. There's also ground isolation built into here. Any of you that are familiar with some of the audio control products as far as getting rid of system noise, engine noise, turn on pops, clicks, hisses, that sort of thing. This has the ability to get rid of a lot of that simply by just moving that little ground jumper. And just like a lot of our products, that ground jumper basically can either separate the system power input ground from the audio ground. It can combine those together, or it can combine those together with some resistance applied. So there's a couple of different settings there to get rid of that more or less. We also have one of our PFM modules in this one. The PFM module essentially acts as a subsonic filter. You can change the frequency of that by ordering a different module. They literally just pop out and plug back in. They're like a little computer chip if you want to think of it that way. So pretty easy to make changes on this one. So if I put the cover on this guy and
I'll jump in here real quick and,
go ahead.
About the 3-2.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think there's much better than the 3-2 when it comes to toys. And, you know, having something that just works awesomely in toys. We got like an account in California who does a lot of toys, boats, side-by-side, stuff like that. And he orders 3-2s, 50 of them at a time. You know, I think when you're talking about a toy and you think back, many of us have been, you know, maybe we're in our 40s or early 50s, and man, a single DIN or, you know, a half DIN EQ was the bomb. I mean, we liked to have that at our fingertips, you know? Same thing today. Yeah, we have DSP. We move more DSP than a 3-2s, but I tell you what, on a toy, there is nothing cooler than to have those knobs, to be able to dial in, to have a master volume control. So it's not only, you know, going into a toy, but the audio is back to being enjoyable. It's a toy, you know, the consumer can play with it. They can have different inputs, you know, so depending on their mood, you know, they have the ability at their fingertips to dictate, you know, if they want it to carry out, you know, further out of the boat or golf cart or whatever it is. So yep. really cool thing. We did have a question on Facebook. So that was, how much different would I get to add if I added an epicenter to my LC1-1500? I have a Kenwood head unit. Adding an epicenter. So the epicenter has been, you know, 28 years. It's a standalone piece. Matthew's going to be talking about a very specific one here in a minute. That would be a great add-on. So even if you have a DSP, even if you have, you know, one of our amplifiers with Accubase in it, an epicenter is going to do something completely different. That epicenter is going to give you bass that you don't have in there. It's going to give you the ability to control that bass that it is bringing into the system, a lot more control, feasibility, everything about it is different. So yes, please go out and get yourself an epicenter and add it onto that LC1-800.
Yeah, and I'll dive more into the epicenter stuff here in just a minute. To expand a little bit on what Chris was talking about with, you know, this being perfect for toys too, before we move on, one of the things that I used to like to do with these and things like these in my store was, especially for doing marine systems, a lot of these smaller boats, you know, a 18-foot Bayliner, a 16-foot whatever, you know, comes into your boat or into your shop, and, you know, what do most of them come with? Most of them come with an aftermarket radio. Most of them come with, you know, four speakers, something like that. And, you know, what do a good majority of those customers want to do? They want to maybe upgrade the speakers. They want to add a set of cans to the tower and maybe a sub, right? That was a good majority of them for me that I did. Maybe the four speakers are already okay. Maybe they're okay with the head unit. They just want to add some tower cans because they see everybody else has them and they want to be the cool kid too. And maybe they want to add a little bit of bass to it. Okay, great. So what are you going to do with that? You could just add an amplifier and a set of cans and a sub, right? Sure you could. But the thing that I used to do with these a lot, and it makes a whole lot of sense, is even if that aftermarket radio is okay, and it's got an okay EQ, and it's got decent crossover points, and it's got all this decent stuff, okay, great. We can leave that alone and still add this, and here's why. Add this to the channels that are going to run to the towers, okay? And now you've got a separate EQ just for the tower cans. It makes perfect sense. Because if you think about it, how many of these systems, if you're anything like me and you've done a ton of these smaller, you know, sub 25-foot boats that, you know, are simple. They're four speakers, maybe six speakers, a pair of cans, an amp or two, one sub. It's all good and fine and it sounds good, but what's the biggest problem with tuning those things? The biggest problem is those cans really need to be tuned differently than the rest of that boat. Those cans don't sound anything like the rest of that boat. Let's be honest, right? Most of those cans anyway are gonna be way more shrill. They're gonna be way more, you know, they're made for projecting obviously. So it makes sense, but wouldn't it be nice to be able to EQ those separately from the rest of the boat? You know, if you do want to try to get a little bit of mid bass or a little bit of bass out of those cans, which is tough to do, you know, maybe you don't want to turn up the bass to the whole boat. Maybe we just want to turn it up for just those cans up on the tower. What a great way to just add control to those And I would probably run the sub through here as well, just so that I get some nice voltage to it and you know, have better control. But what better way to do that? You know, I mean, it makes perfect sense. So anyhow, before we move on, I just wanted to mention that. I did also, while I had the top plate off of this guy, I did switch the illumination color. So there you guys can see it lit up red, took 2 seconds to do. Pretty cool. So with that, we'll move on to some of our other products we're going to talk about today. I don't want to get too hung up and take all of our time. So the next thing that we're going to talk about is the Epicenter InDash. The Epicenter InDash is a really, really cool product. Again, like a lot of the audio control products, it's really kind of like nothing else. There's really nothing else quite like it. The 3.2 is cool and it is unique, and there are some features that nobody else has on it. I think the biggest feature with the 3.2 is just that it's a super high quality, really well built in-dash EQ or half din. I shouldn't call it in-dash, I should just call it half din EQ. And really, there's not many people making that, you know? So if you're in the market for one of those, it's a great, great toy. So the Epicenter InDash is pretty slick. Chris brought up earlier a question from someone asking, you know, should I add an Epicenter to my amplifier? If I already have an audio control amp, you know, should I do it? So on and so forth. The answer is yes, as long as you don't have one of the Epicenter series amplifiers, right? If you have one of the Epicenter amplifiers, okay, fine. It's got Epicenter built in. You're not gonna need it. But for all of our other amplifiers, please do not confuse Accubase for Epicenter. That's a common mistake that a lot of consumers make, is they see some sort of technology included in the amplifier features list that has to do with bass, and they just assume, okay, cool, it's got an Epicenter built into it. That is not the case. So Epicenter and Accubase are two very different things. The Epicenter technology is really all about bass restoration. And when we talk about bass restoration, what we really mean is, you know, the ability to restore bass that isn't present in the source material. And by source material, I mean CD, cassette, Bluetooth, MP3, iPod, smartphone, Pandora, satellite radio, whatever, okay? Whatever your preferred source is, all of those sources, for the most part, except for maybe a CD, you know, have some loss involved. Especially when you're talking about traditional MP3s on a thumb drive, or, you know, we have a lot of younger consumers these days who unfortunately play their music off of YouTube, right? Because it's free, there's access to pretty much everything on the planet, and they're used to it, right? The younger generation, YouTube is their go-to for pretty much everything. So, you know, whereas maybe some of us that are in our 30s and 40s, you know, we go to maybe Pandora or Spotify or iTunes or Tidal or something like that. A lot of the younger generation don't. They go straight to YouTube. And the problem with playing music off of YouTube is, unless you're a paid subscriber and getting the really high quality stuff, the majority of the material on YouTube is really pretty poor as far as audio quality goes. And just like compressed MP3s and, you know, getting music off Napster back in the day and all that stuff, the biggest problem with that music is, what do they do to compress it? You know, in that compression process, you lose the high highs and the low lows. Well, the low lows are what we're concerned about today, right? So what the Epicenter really does, you guys, is it restores bass back into source material that doesn't have it. And that could be a couple of things. That can be music like I just talked about, where the bass is lost because of the conversion process or the compression, or maybe the bass is lost because the music doesn't have it. Some music just doesn't have that low note that you were hoping for. So a real quick explanation of what Epicenter technology really does. Excuse me. Epicenter technology restores bass back into the signal where there was none, and it puts it in one octave below the lowest present frequency. So to elaborate a little bit on that, let's say we have a song that we're playing, and that song, its lowest bass note is 60 hertz. So it's got a nice 60 hertz punchy, you know, kick you in the stomach type bass note. But what it doesn't have is any of that real low bass that shakes the whole car. Now, you could boost that song and jack with the EQ all day long, but if the material's not there, there's just nothing to boost, right? You're just boosting nothing at that point. So what the Epicenter technology really does is it puts bass in there. So if the lowest frequency, like I said, was 60 hertz, what the Epicenter is gonna do is put bass in one octave below. So if it was at 60, the Epicenter is gonna put bass in at 30. So now that song that originally just had that kind of, you know, good punchy bass now has good punchy bass and some really nice low shake the whole car type low end bass. So it's really, really cool. And when it's set up properly, it works incredibly well. One of the things to keep in mind with all Epicenters, whether it's the traditional trunk mount Epicenter that a lot of you are familiar with, or whether it's the Epicenter in-dash like we're talking about today, one of the things to keep in mind is that you need to feed a pretty much full range signal into your Epicenter for it to work properly. Like I just explained a minute ago, the Epicenter is looking upstream in the audio mix, and it's looking for whatever that lowest bass frequency is, and then it is filling in one octave below. Well, the problem with that can be if you have your aftermarket stereo in the dash, let's say, and you're using the sub outs from that aftermarket stereo, chances are you've crossed them over in that stereo, or they maybe even be crossed over from just default. So if those are crossed over at say 80 hertz, okay, that's a common frequency to pick. Low pass filter at 80, that's a pretty good choice, okay. But if the Epicenter can't see anything above 80 hertz, how well is it gonna work if you play a song whose lowest bass note is above 80? The Epicenter is not going to be able to see that frequency very well and do its job. So whenever we get a call from somebody that says, you know, some songs are just absolutely booming and slamming and this thing bumps, and then other songs, there's like nothing there. What's going on? I just have this weird low rumble. Generally, it's because they fed a signal into their Epicenter that wasn't full range enough. Now we say to feed it full range, the Epicenter will look at up to 1000 hertz. So it doesn't necessarily have to be full range, but we do want something fed into it more than just your traditional 80 hertz low pass, you know, sub signal, something like that. If you do have to run it off of the sub out of a head unit or whatever product, see if you can turn that crossover either off, you know, pass through, full range, whatever they want to call it, or see if you can just turn it up as high as it'll go. If the setting on that will go up to 250, okay, we'll take it. You know, 250 will work. We would like to see it higher, but you know, we'll take what we can get, right? So that's just a little word on Epicenter tech in general. So the things that make the Epicenter in-dash unique and different are a couple of cool things. Obviously, this has the Epicenter technology built in. That's gonna be your knob here on the far side. This is your bass restoration, okay? So this is how much Epicenter effect we have. This is not overall sub control. This is Epicenter effect. Okay, it's labeled as bass restoration. There's also a restoration on and off switch. So again, you can kick your Epicenter on or off, maybe for certain things you don't want it engaged. Again, you're listening to the ball game on a Sunday or listening to some talk radio or a podcast that just doesn't need it. You don't have to turn down restoration. You can just click a knob and disengage it, which is cool. Also, it's great for doing before and after demos, or you know, if you are a retailer watching this, it's a cool way to do demos and show them how big of a difference this piece really makes. The next one that's on here is our Parabass. Parabass is really pretty cool. This gives you essentially a center frequency and then a width of that slope on either side of your center frequency. So if you're using frequency here to choose, you know, whatever, 40 hertz, it's obviously not going to just enhance 40 hertz. You're going to use the width here to determine how wide on either side of 40 hertz do we want to affect. So it's a pretty cool piece, something that's a little bit different from what anybody else has. That adjustment there on Parabass is capable of doing anywhere from 27 hertz up to 63 hertz. So that's the adjustment that's on here, is 27 to 63. So really those prime frequencies that we would want to focus on anyway. So we've got a nice little boost there. The other cool thing that's built into this that I think is super unique, and it's one of those things that you're just not really going to find in other products, is this has a 160 dB capable in-dash SPL meter built in. So your microphone is here on the far side of the product. This little display here is an SPL display, which is pretty cool. This actually has a real readout. It's a pretty accurate little microphone that's built into there. Because we spent years and years and years and years, you know, using our equipment to do DB drag racing and, you know, USAC and IASCA and all these different sanctioned events, we have obviously a fair bit of experience with SPL meters and what type of microphones to use and that sort of technology. So we use that experience and put that into this product to come up with something really unique and cool that gives you and your, you know, kind of base head enthusiast customers, really a cool, you know, kind of toy to show off with their friends. But something else that's built in that's really kind of useful is the volt meter. So there is a little button on here we can switch, and it just switches the display from a volt meter from the SPL. There's also a peak hold feature. So peak hold can be used to show that peak SPL feature on there, be able to show off to your buddies how loud your car is or how loud the system is. It's a really cool piece. You know, it's something, like I said, it's something unique that not everybody is going to have. You know, are there other things out there that try to restore bass like an Epicenter? We've been copied a million times, right? But none of them are really quite the same as an Epicenter. And I get asked that a lot. We get asked by consumers all the time, or I get asked by guys at trade shows and stuff, you know, hey, why don't I just buy the regular old fill in the blank X brand, off brand bass restoration piece? Doesn't it do the same thing? And the thing is they really don't, okay? The technology that's in an Epicenter is patented, and it is different. It is not the same as your $20, $30, $40, $50, $60 you know, eBay special base restoration piece. So although a lot of people have copied us and tried to make the same thing, none of them have been, you know, completely successful at pulling that off. One other cool thing on the Epicenter in-dash that is on the back panel of this guy is it is a traditional RCA input, RCA output, but it also does have speaker level input. So if you are doing a, you know, using an OEM stereo to put some bass in a vehicle, you can use the Epicenter in-dash as your high to low converter, your line driver, your Epicenter processor. You've got parametric bass control as well. What more do you need? You've also got an SPL meter and a voltage meter. It's a pretty cool toy, right? Chris was talking earlier about toys and you know, the joy of audio with some of this stuff. This is a pretty cool toy, something that a lot of guys can appreciate. Now, this one also does switch from blue to red illumination, same as the other, the 3.2. We take the top case off of this guy and pop this off.
While you're doing that, Matthew, there's a couple of statements and questions. So
yeah.
Joe Miranda says, I have a 401 that's connected to a DSP. I truly love how simple it is to tweak a song quickly and really gives a nice touch to the install. Couldn't agree more. Like when we're talking about, you know, audio being fun, you know, how fun is it to have to go into a menu to find, you know, bass or treble or something like that? You know, when you have somebody in the car and you're like, dude, you got to listen to this, you know?
Yeah.
How cool is that to have to go through a menu and then play around with it? With all these in-dash things, it's right there. It's handy. So even if you do have a DSP, you know, this gives you quick, easy, global access, you know, to that tuned DSP. So I think it's really cool. And then talking about the Epicenter, I asked the question and nobody replied, but anyone know the original name of the Epicenter? Do you know, Matthew?
I do. You want me to share it?
Go for it.
The Richter scale.
So there is just as a reference, just the Epicenter. You know, the Epicenter, phase coupled activator, Richter scales were all created back when during mastering they were taking bass out of music because back then in the 70s, everybody was listening to their records in consoles.
Yep.
And bass in them would make the record skip. And so they started mastering out during the 60s and 70s, a lot of the deep bass out of music. So that's why the Epicenter was created. And luckily, you know, with today's music, different genres of music, we have the ability to create bass an octave lower that's not present in the music. So if you listen to, you know, classic rock, country music, banda music, anything like that, that you don't get anything below 60 hertz.
Yeah.
Epicenter is an absolute must, and a very cool piece. Getting the Epicenter in dash is even cooler because it has that SPL meter on it. It has, you know, the ability to just ride on the fly, grab it, and do some really cool stuff.
Yeah. And with that too, you know, I mean, I think the thing that a lot of guys look at with the Epicenters is, you know, there's a lot of retailers, I think specifically, that go, those are for Bonda Music, or those are for fill in the blank. But the thing to remember too is that they're also great for classic rock. A lot of classic rock doesn't have, you know, quite the bass we'd like it to. Or like Chris said, a lot of older recordings. If you just have a customer that likes, you know, music from the 60s and 70s or whatever, which a lot of us are going to have customers that enjoy that music. That music, like Chris mentioned, had the bass mixed out of it during recording. We didn't want our records to skip, right? Somebody mentioned, you know, me mentioning Napster on the chat. Yes, I'm definitely showing my age by mentioning Napster. Some of you probably have never heard of that. So I'm aging myself there. But yeah, so the other cool thing to think about with the Epicenter, you guys, is that I've mentioned this in some of our other trainings that focused on Epicenter. And that is that there are going to be vehicles that you just need an Epicenter for. Forget about what type of music they listen to. Forget about, you know, what type of music player they're using or what their source is. There are some vehicles that just need the restoration. And the one that I always bring up is the newer Honda Accords. The reason I always bring this one up is because I've seen it in person. I've seen it myself. And one of our reps in the Phoenix market has a 18 Honda Accord. He added our amplifiers, some Focal 12s, really a nice setup. And it really didn't have the output, especially in the lower notes, that you would expect from a setup of this caliber. I mean, it was two of our LC1.800s, one per woofer. I mean, it was a lot of power, a lot of bass, a lot of gear went into that car. And what we found out with the DMRTA and going through and checking out the factory signal was that in the base model Accords of that generation, Honda has actually high-passed the whole system. So it's not volume dependent. It's not bass roll off like we've all experienced in the past. This was purely a permanent high pass filter in the factory radio. And this was the base model Accord. So this has a screen in the dash, no CD player, I believe, and then just four, you know, 6.5-inch speakers, and that's it. No amp, no sub, nothing fancy. With that car, everything below about 60 hertz was steeply rolled off. So of course you add 1600 watts RMS and 212s, it doesn't matter. There's nothing below 60 hertz or not much below 60 hertz to play. So you can have the biggest amp subs and system in the world, but if there's no source material there, what are they gonna do? Not much, right? So in his system, we used an Epicenter in line between the factory radio and I believe he's got a DSP in there. In between, you know, his first piece of his signal chain is an Epicenter in that car to restore that bass that's lost. The other cool thing about the Epicenter Plus though is, you know, a lot of guys sometimes have trouble dialing in their Epicenter exactly where they want it because the controls are on the Epicenter themselves and they're usually mounting that Epicenter back in the trunk or in the hatch area back by their amplifiers, etc. It would be really nice to have that stuff, you know, right up front, right where you can get to it. It makes complete sense. You know, being able to do all of that right from the driver's seat definitely makes sense. It's a pretty cool piece. So while we were talking there, I popped the top off of this one. I changed the color of it to blue. You can see it lit up blue now. Pretty cool. And inside on this one, kind of a cool PC board. This one does have, somebody had Spike as their background earlier. Let me get up and bring this guy up there. See if you can see him on there. Yep, there he is. He's right on the PC board. So Spike is on the board on this one. This one also does have the ground isolation as well. So if you do get any sort of noise or turn on, turn off pops, clicks, etc., you can certainly use that ground jumper to try to help eliminate some of that stuff.
There's a couple of questions.
Go ahead.
Facebook. So one is, are there dash kits or is this a full single DIN unit? So all the in-dash pieces are half DIN. Matthew, maybe you can address some of the mounting options. Yep. What it is. And then another question was, does an Epicenter exist for home audio anymore?
So a couple of good questions there. So the first one, talking about mounting on these guys, that's a great question. Thanks for bringing it up. On both of these in-dash type products, these are half DIN products. So these are about half the size of a traditional single CD player type product. So if your vehicle is a double DIN or a DIN and a half, you know, GM, Chrysler, something like that, these will obviously stack nicely right below or above your aftermarket disc player or head unit, I should say. But these also do have the mounting holes on the side here. That's how they're normally going to be ISO mounted into your set up in the dash, but we also do include a set of brackets that come with these, and those set of brackets are some nice metal L brackets. So if you do want to just undermount this or under dash mount it, I should say, or something like that, you certainly can. Also, a lot of the dash kit manufacturers out there, I have seen some pretty cool kits from Metra and Amp of America, et cetera, that will allow you to put a half DIN piece like this in a single DIN opening. So if you do have, say, a older boat, maybe you've got a 10-year-old Bayliner that's still a great boat, but that old radio is just junk and you don't really want a radio in there anymore, that thing's got to go. They do make kits to just pull out a single DIN and put just a half DIN unit back in its place and make it still look nice. So there are definitely some cool options for that. As far as Epicenter for home use, that's one of the places it started. So we started out as something called a phase coupled activator or a Richter scale. The Richter scale was more or less Epicenter for home. As far as a current product, Chris can correct me if I'm wrong. I don't know if he knows either, but I don't believe there is a dedicated, I know there's not a dedicated Epicenter for home. Some of our home products have Accubase in them, and some of them have some other features, but I don't believe Epicenter technology is one of them.
Yeah, I would say go ahead and help yourself to use the Epicenter in-dash in the home. I think that'd be a cool piece to have. And you know, we do have a lot of guys that will use some of our mobile products in rack systems and stuff like that for different applications. There was another question on here, but somebody asked, that they have customers that ask how to add an Epicenter to a DM810. And so that's a great question. What you would want to do is go ahead and use one of the outputs out of any processor. And the nice thing with the processor is it gives you the ability to open up that crossover. So you can rely on the PFM and the crossover in the Epicenter and amplifier, open up the frequency response out of the DSP, out of any of the outputs, and add an Epicenter post DSP. Really, really good question. And absolutely, an Epicenter is one of those things. It's like, if a customer has ever had one, he's going to have one. If he's getting an audio and he ever had an Epicenter, he is going to get another Epicenter. So
yeah, he's gonna want one.
Even with the most modern system with, the greatest DSP on the market, the Epicenter is still a standalone piece that makes a lot of sense to add post DSP so that Epicenter can do all that work. And it doesn't need to be fall in between the DSP, because it actually has way more voltage output than any of the DSPs on the market. So, you can use it as a post DSP preamp to really get your base where the customer wants it. So
yeah, that's actually it's a cool topic too. And like with the Epicenter in-dash specifically, if you're going to do maybe our DM608, let's say, or DM810, one of our standalones, you could, depending on what the factory system is like, you could potentially use this as your high to low converter, and then run RCA out of this straight into that DM, and then do everything in the DM processor and out to the amplifiers. And you could actually do this as your first piece of the puzzle if you really wanted to. An interesting one that I got the other day, you guys, that I thought was actually it was a great question, and it took me a second to kind of think it through and give the guy an answer. But the question was, well, I have one of your D6-1200 amplifiers and I want to add an Epicenter. So the question was, can I feed in four channels of RCA and then on the DSP RCA output on the D6-1200? Can I take that output, loop it out into an epicenter, out of the epicenter, back into the D6-1200 for input? And you absolutely could. You could certainly use it like that and basically loop an epicenter into a D6-1200. I had to kind of walk through it because it took me a second to go, you know, would that work? But it would absolutely work. There's no reason why that wouldn't work. It's actually pretty brilliant. I mean, it's basically strapping on an epicenter into the D6-1200, and it would totally work. It's genius. Car Toys in Oklahoma was actually the ones I was talking to that we had to kind of work through that together. But we're going, you know, that's actually a really good idea. It's like an add-on module at that point. So, and he confirmed it certainly worked beautifully. So anyhow, you can add an epicenter to just about anything, you guys. You just have to sometimes get a little bit creative, right? So pretty cool, right, Chris?
Really, really cool. I never put that together unless
me neither. No, nobody's ever asked. You know, nobody's ever asked me if they could do that. But once he and I started talking about it, it's like, you know what? That would totally work. It makes perfect sense. So pretty cool.
Somebody did ask, can they adjust the output voltage on the in-dash epicenter just like the epicenter?
The output voltage on this guy. I believe on this one you can. Yeah, this one has, let me pop this top off here again and I can show you guys. Let's see, that is calibration, adjustment, no, balanced and unbalanced on this one. That's right. So not a specific
like indicator.
Pardon?
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just saying, not a specific voltage adjustment like you would normally move, you know, 2, 5, or 10 volts. It doesn't have that like the traditional one does. This is just going to have balanced and unbalanced as far as the inputs outputs here. This does have adjustments internally, though, for the SPL meter and the voltage meter. So I have been asked before, you know, hey, my voltage meter here at the epicenter in dash seems to be reading, you know, 0.2 different than wherever else in the car they checked it or whatever. Chances are it's just a difference of voltage drop between the two points. But if you did want this to match a certain point in the vehicle for some reason, you could certainly adjust that internally and have this match whatever point it is that you multimetered and make them line up the same. So with us getting towards the end of things here, I don't want to run out of time. So let's move on to the matrix before we get to the end. So the matrix is another really cool product. One of those ones that I think, you know, gets forgotten about quite a bit. I think a lot of guys kind of forget that this type of product still exists or that these types of things are still necessary. You know, I think the assumption a lot of times is that, well, I don't really need this type of thing anymore because, you know, my customer is using an aftermarket head unit with 3 sets of preamp outputs, or we're using DSPs for everything, or, you know, whatever the case may be. But that's not always the case, right? Like we talked about earlier, not every car is a DSP car. Not every system is going to have an aftermarket radio. You know, I mean, every car is going to be different. Excuse me, every system is going to be a little bit different. So it's one of those things where it makes sense to have products like this available. So with this piece, this is basically a 6-channel line driver, okay? But it's also going to give you the ability to control each of the input sources separately, more or less. So think of it like this. If you have a customer that maybe has a you know, source unit that only has 1 set of preamp outputs, but they don't want to replace that source unit, or they're just happy with it, or they bought it recently and they wish they would have bought a higher end model, or whatever the case may be, okay? They don't have to replace that. You can literally feed in 1 set of RCA inputs into this guy, 1 set of signal in on the front main, and we can get, excuse me, this side's the input. We can get all 6 channels of this to be that same output. So this can take in 1 set of RCA and give us all 6 channels out. We could run all 3 sets in and get all 3 sets out. The matrixing ability of this is pretty cool. So just like our processors, you can basically, you know, assign these channels however you wish. The other cool thing with the matrix is the ability to take an ACR1 and plug it in here. plugs in right down here on the side of the product, okay? So plug in an ACR1, and you can either have it be a control unit to just control the sub channel 3 outputs, or we can use that controller, the ACR1, to control all of the outputs, depending on how this piece is configured. The other one that I always want to mention with the matrix, and I think this gets lost in the mix a lot of times, is guys look at these and they go, well, my deck has 3 sets of preamp outputs, I'm good, I don't need anything like that. But what about the guys running the big systems, okay? What about the guys that are doing, 3, 4, 5, 6 sub-amplifiers, okay? You need something to drive up that line voltage to run all of those amplifiers. You know, if you've ever used Y adapters to try to do a setup like that, it doesn't end well, right? I mean, you're reducing the voltage every time you Y it like that, and the results are not what you'd hoped for. Use a matrix, and I mean, we can get 13 volts of output on those RCA outs on this thing. 13 volts is a lot. Obviously, there's a lot of amplifiers that will not take 13 volts in, but if you've got 13 volts worth of output capability, we could use this thing to run numerous amplifiers in an SPL setup or just a big build that has, you know, multiple sub-amplifiers. Doesn't necessarily have to be an SPL build. Again, some of these bigger marine systems is a popular application for the matrix. They don't want to have all of these different, controllers everywhere. They don't want to have all of these different, splits for all the RCAs. Maybe they're using amplifiers that don't have pass-throughs. You know, whatever the case may be, if you've got one set of full range inputs that you want to bring in and you need to run, 3, 4 channel amplifiers running full range to accommodate enough channels to cover this big boat in audio or whatever the case may be, the matrix is a great contender for that. So with the matrix, you pop the top off of this guy. This has the not dip switches, but the jumpers, I should say, inside to be able to basically assign the channels and either run them as separate ins passed out, or whether you want to bring in one and connect it to main, or however you want to do that. There's cool little indicators on here that say connected to main. If those are lit up, that tells you that that channel output is getting its input from the main. So if we are only bringing in 2 channels, but we want all 6 channels of output to be the same as that 1, 2 input, all of those connected to main indicators should be lit up. The indicators on the far side of the product over here are showing our voltage on the output side, so we can help to kind of gain match this and set this up to match with whatever amplifiers the outputs of this are going to. And these little lights will light up as you bring up these dials. So as you bring up these output dials, you'll start to see these indicators light up, so you can pretty easily gain match it to whatever that amplifier is. So if that amplifier can only handle, 2 volts of input, let's say, we would want to just bring this guy up until we hit that 2 volt mark, and then you're at least real close. So some pretty cool stuff built into the matrix. Like I said, I think the SPL side of it, or the large system side of it, is one of those that a lot of times gets forgotten, and it's still a very viable, useful product. If you've never had a system with a line driver or had a system that has some real hot preamp voltage, do yourself a favor and get something that'll bring up that line voltage, pretty much any audio control product. And it's a world of difference once you have a real hot signal like that in those types of systems. Makes a world of difference.
Hey, I'm going to hop off this call, Matthew. I just want to thank everybody personally for being here. Matthew's going to continue on and go over some stuff. So you have the questions, my friend.
Sounds good.
That did come up was mentioned using it on a boat. These in-dash pieces, are they conformally coated? And no, they are not conformally coated right now. Another question was the HPX. And if we're going to be going over that, the HPX has been long discontinued. So we will not be touching on the HPX. So thanks, guys. Have a great day. Matthew, thank you. Great job. And the rest of the training, everybody.
All right. Have a good one, Chris. Thanks. Just switch back here. Cool, guys. So we're just about to wrap things up. So anyhow, yeah, with these pieces, like Chris mentioned, they are not conformally coated. The the two pieces that I showed you today are the only in-dash pieces that Audio Control currently offers. So if you're curious about the 4.1 or the HPX or any of those, the great pieces, but those have been discontinued. We're really trying to focus on the pieces that make the most sense for today's market and today's customers. So to answer that question, somebody also did ask if they're conformally coded. Chris did quickly answer that and let you know that they are not conformally coded. However, the 3.2 will go through, I don't want to call it a renovation, but we will be kind of changing the 3.2 a little bit in the future to include a conformally coded board probably next year or so. So look out for that in the future, maybe next summer or something along those lines. So anyhow, that pretty much wraps it up for today, guys. Thank you so much for spending some time with us. I know there's lots of things you could do with 1 hour of your day. So I genuinely appreciate your support and coming to these trainings.